Thanks for staying with us. Now, the challenges that Nigeria continues to face are mainly the paucity of its revenue and the poor institutional interest to apply efficiency to its expenditure. No significant cuts have been made to its overhead, and its opaque statutory spending has continued to surge. For instance, after a long negotiation with the Nigerian Labour Congress, that's the NLC, Nigeria finally agreed to raise its minimum wage to 30,000 naira, that's about $85, which significantly adds over 600 billion naira to the federal government's personal costs, further increasing an already bloated expenditure budget. Now, the current state of Nigeria's budget reveals that the spectra of a country that's severely underinvested in health and education in previous years. This was an analysis written by Budget. Olusegun Onigbinde is a Nigerian entrepreneur and an open data analyst, popularly known as the co-founder and CEO of Budget, a Nigerian civic startup. Olusegun Onigbinde is a fiscal transparency advocate and a firm believer in the power of open data. Budget is a civic organization driven to make the Nigerian budget and public data more understandable and accessible across every literacy span. Their primary goal is to use creative technology to intersect civic engagement and institutional reforms. Now, remember, you can join this conversation. Tweet us at PlusTVAfrica or at WaysShowAfrica1 with the hashtag Ways, or you send us an SMS or WhatsApp to 081-8038-4663. Thank you so much for joining us, Olusegun.
Yeah, thank you. It's a whole pleasure.
All right, so this is one subject that I think I am, anyone that knows me, I always say that I am completely ground zero when it comes to finance, budget, and all of that, you know. But in my little understanding of what a budget should look like, right? Now, this is my personal opinion. A budget should have something somewhat, maybe a starting point should be a vision, right?
Yeah.
When we now have a vision, this is what we want to do. We now move on to a plan, right? When we have a plan, we now say, okay, so what is the budget for this plan that we have put out? And then under that budget, we now have something like, what's it called? The figures and the execution date, right? Yep. Like timelines.
Yeah, exactly.
So when I see the national budget in Nigeria, is this the plan they follow, or is this something different?
All right. I mean, thank you for so much. It's glad to speak of PlusTV Africa. And to be very honest with you, the Nigerian budget is more of a spending tool than the plan document. So you find out that when you read the Nigerian budget, you see less conversations around public budgeting, I mean, around planning. No, because when you look at planning, you plan in possibly three phases, you know, basics, which is long-term planning, medium-term planning, and short-term plan. So in Nigeria, for example, as at today, the last medium-term plan that we had as a country was the ERGP, this Economic Recovery and Growth Plan. After that, which expires this year, after that, we don't have any plan on ground about how we move forward. So what you see in Nigerian budget are just possibly contracting items. I mean, you see construction of schools, construction of hospitals, construction of balls, and whatever you say in there. But it's not tied to like an outcome. When you say construction of schools, what are you trying to drive out? You know, the budget should be linked to some form of improvement in the society. So we don't do budget properly in Nigeria. We're just trying to find a way to legitimize public spending. And that's what you get. That's why when you have public officials say, okay, XYZ has been spent in public budgeting. I mean, it's all tied to, oh, the funds have been spent and it is validated, and then that's just it, and I can just move forward with that. So the way we do budgeting is not the right way in Nigeria, and we have constantly said that let there be a clear line of thinking around how we plan public resources in Nigeria. It is very, very important. Yeah.
Okay, so for me, I think for if we want to go by, okay, what, so based on what you are saying, it means that we don't really, really have a budget. What we are just doing is we're just spending money, right? And trying to legitimize, in your word, you know, our spending. So if we say we want to even do this, I mean, legitimate this spending or legitimize the spending, I feel that the biggest bane of budget is the execution, right?
Yep.
That's what I feel. You know, so what affects execution of budget?
I mean, so it's always about public revenues and also secondly about priority of the government. So in Nigerian budget, now you have close to 4,000 items, you know, that align in the budget as capital items. So and you can imagine that you cannot execute 4,000 items in the budget every year. So what we do is that we have a small pie, but we spread it too thin. So we are trying to, you see, the federal government is trying to even, you know, is trying to do a 5 million naira project, a 10 million naira project. We don't even prioritize what is necessary. So that's why you see an abundance of uncompleted projects over the years and over the years. And it's the first challenge when you see budget execution. Every player in the Nigerian governance system should have priorities. So what should be the priority of the local government? Primary healthcare centers, primary education, and you heavily invest in that. What should be the primary response of the state government, of the federal government? But you see the federal government even trying to dig a borehole in the local community. So that's the first problem when it comes to the execution of the project. The second one has now to do with revenues. No matter how much you look at Nigeria's budget, it's not that huge. It's not that significant. So, I mean, we are a country of 200 million people, if we take that statistic, which sometimes could be very debatable. But our entire budget is around 9 trillion naira or 10 trillion naira. You adjust that even with the new exchange rate, that's something around $25 to $26 billion. I mean, that's not even up to police department spending in some countries, I mean, in like in the US. So, I mean, we look at the budget of Nigeria extremely small for the size of people that we have. So, and because we can't even, we don't even make that, we don't even have a revenue of 10 trillion naira. We don't. We don't have revenue every year is around 4.8 trillion naira, around 4.5 trillion naira. So you're borrowing massively to cover that gap. So the second element that is critical is the size of our revenue, extremely small. Why is it small? Number one, the formalization of businesses in Nigeria. So most of the businesses in Nigeria are grossly informal. So taxation is a bit difficult to even take from that space. Number two is also you look at the small businesses in Nigeria. Small businesses in Nigeria are extremely challenged. I mean, in some sort of way, you have some businesses not being able even to even have the pathway for paying taxes is not eased. So it's a bit very, very difficult for even to remit tax. I mean, I was arguing with some friends yesterday, what's the incentive to be formalized in Nigeria? Because the only reason why you want to be formalized in Nigeria is that the government is not chasing you for growth. The government is not chasing you to employ more people. The only reason why the government is chasing you is so that they can take taxes off you. In that kind of system, there is no incentive to be formalized. So it comes across in a way about how we as a people have to critically think, you know, about how does government raise public revenue? And that might even be the wrong question. The wrong question is how does government now even raise, you know, how does government engineer growth within the Nigerian society? That has to be extremely fundamental in things in Nigeria. Yeah.
Based on the last statement you just made, how does government raise
growth
in Nigeria? So what are the areas that are likely to impede successful budget implementation, especially in the three tiers of government?
So, I mean, if you look at us, I mean, since the 70s, I mean, since we were born, you know, Nigeria has always been around oil and oil. Since we discovered oil and we had this Arab oil crisis in 73 and oil prices went from $3 per barrel over 9 to $12 per barrel and we found sudden wealth from oil. You know, Nigeria has constantly classified its economy by non-oil growth or non-oil growth or oil revenue or non-oil revenue. So we just practically become a country, you know, just defined by oil and crude and gas and other elements. And so if you study the pattern of Nigeria's growth right from the 80s, when oil prices are high, the economy grows high. I mean, the growth is high. I mean, we're doing 8%, we're doing 6%. When oil prices dip, then suddenly we are finding ourselves in recession. So, and I think it's an existential question for Nigeria that Nigeria cannot constantly be driven around by the sudden cyclical movement in the oil price, in the oil market. And it's becoming very much more frequent now. Look at us. I mean, in 2009, there was a recession. You know, we were able to survive that recession. in a much more stronger, in a better way, because we had a cushion. We had been saving over the years. We had money in excess good account. We had money in the reserves. Now in 2014, we had the reverse situation. Oil prices, 5 years later, oil prices dipped again. Now in 2020, due to some irresponsible countries not being able to move fast enough on the current pandemic, oil prices go on a tailspin again. Suddenly, we're already talking about that GDP can contract as much as 8.9% in a year. So in some sort of way, the fundamental reason why we might not be able to find growth this year is just because the Nigeria, even despite that, the oil sector is around 9% of Nigeria's GDP. But in the economy, oil has a huge pull around other sectors. So you see a whole lot of oil services, a whole lot of household expenditure are all tied to oil, or to the oil sector. So suddenly when oil prices go down, you have two factors that are still challenged. Public revenues are challenged, and government is still a big spender within the environment. Two, your foreign exchange earnings are challenged. 95%, as of 2019, 95% of Nigeria's foreign exchange earnings comes from crude oil or gas. I mean, so definitely when you're struggling with that, you can't grow. So the only way for Nigeria is not just to diversify the economy. Well, the economy is diversified already, but diversify your public revenues and diversify your foreign exchange earnings in a much more way that oil becomes less significant. Because if we have a cyclical movement of oil of boom and it's going bust in 5 years, before you know it, it will now become a trend of 2 years, a trend of 3 years. And how do you grow in a way that today you are growing at 4-5%? Then suddenly you are back to minus 1.5%, and suddenly you are back to 8% just because oil prices are dipping. So Nigeria has to delink its economy from oil. It's something that we keep saying that we're diversifying.
We do.
It's cliche and it's trite, but it's now good to see that. What would Nigeria sell to the world apart from oil? That's a fundamental question to Nigeria's existence.
Okay, I like what you just said about what would Nigeria sell to the world, right? Apart from crude oil. There's this book that was written by a great man that I read, Start With What You Have. Dr. Sam Adeyemi wrote that book. And if we look at the principles, Nigeria, we have a lot of things and we're not even harnessing what we have. Right? And in my own, let me come back to my market woman style. If I have 1,000 naira, right? And they say that I need to feed maybe my family, and we are maybe a family of four, and I have 1,000 naira. If I am to draw my budget, would I be drawing a budget based on 5,000 naira, or I would draw a budget based on what I have? If I were to, because I want to tie this analysis to Nigeria. I mean, currently now they say the IMF loan, we want to, we're trying to borrow money and all of that. I'm wondering, is this what we need right now? Is this good for our budget? Basing the fact that the overheads, based on what we read earlier about budget, the overhead is too much in Nigeria in terms of governance and all of that. Can't we start with what we have and cut down all of these excesses, and instead of going again outside to go and get foreign loans, to further impoverish us?
Okay. I mean, you're
hello,
very right.
And welcome to what
I'm... There's this quote that says, it's only when the tides are out that you know who is swimming naked. When oil prices are high, when public revenues, when they look more stable, Nigeria tends to do the wrong things, tend to float the tides of government. And you're dealing with public revenues that are very few, because of your dependence on oil market. A lot of decisions that you can't, it's hard to take some deep cost-cutting decisions when you are flirting with the recession, because you need public spending, you need stimulation of expenditure within the environment just to keep the economy going. So that's why you see that everywhere across the world, everybody's talking about stimulus. Government is talking about stimulus in US, in China, in everywhere across the world, even in South Africa, even Kenya yesterday released its stimulus package for the economy. So when you are faced with a contraction, it's not a time you say, oh, we want to cut expenditure. And I'm going to come back to cutting expenditure because I know where you're going to. But if you look at the size of public spending, our recurrent expenditure, there are two major elements in our recurrent expenditure. And one is public services cost, which is a personnel cost. The second one is a debt servicing. Even the overhead that we all talk about is less than 300 billion naira. So if you are putting 300 billion naira in a budget of 9 trillion naira, you can't go far. But you have a public, a personnel cost of around 2.6 trillion. You have a debt servicing cost, servicing debt, around 2.8 trillion. So that alone itself, you're taking expenditure to somewhere around 5.5 trillion naira. I mean, adjustment of either of those two items are going to transform, you know, the public service and the government expenditure. So if we are going to ask questions, maybe we have to go and restructure our loans so that we have much more longer time to pay. That will have a significant impact on our credit rating. Or maybe we have to make, at the point, make some adjustment on our personal costs. But is it the time? Is this now the time that you want to sack workers? I mean, those are the kind of difficult policy choices you cannot easily make now. That's why I say when the tides are high, that's why you could have made all those adjustments to say, okay, how do I tune the civil service to be more efficient? How do I raise a bond to pay people off so that I can have a much more agile and a much more stronger civil society, civil service? I mean, how do I make sure that some agencies are in government that have no business taking funds from public treasury? They could actually live on their own and be self-liquidating. If they have to die, then let them die on their own. But all of those decisions we can't make now just because you are in a space where you want to stimulate public spending, and sacking workers is not, might not be the quick decision that you have to make on the spot right now. And that's why Nigeria needs, when the tides are high, that's when we need to make the hard decisions. The second part is that you also need to do a bit of signaling. So we can have the environment, you know, citizens struggling, I mean, to live or to feed. They now have public officials continue as they have always been. I mean, this is the time where you have leaders saying, we're going to take a 25% cut in our earnings from government. This is the time the National Assembly should stand up and say, we're going to be more transparent and we're going to take a 25% cut in our spending and all of that. I mean, this is time to signal that the cities, the leaders can also be a part of the burden, you know, and make part of the adjustment so that they can create much more space.
Talk.
Much more. But we are not seeing that. Carrying on as if it is a normal day. Because we can even make it adjustment. But it's not serious adjustment. I mean, is that the reality of Nigeria today? No. I mean, so, and that's the problem. When nobody is willing to take the sacrifice. Everybody wants to milk the system as much as possible for their own benefit. And in that kind of way, we're not going to get any progress forward. Yeah.
So, you've been talking about expenditure, you've been talking about GDP, you've been giving us all these financial terms. But for those who are like the market woman, the layman on the road, who doesn't understand these terminologies, how do you explain it or simplify it? Because to ensure public participation, how do you simplify it to ensure that I, on my own, somebody who is in the market, can understand the budget? How do you simplify it?
I mean, to be very honest with you, when we say GDP, when the economy grows, everybody enjoys it. I mean, I remember when I was younger, my mom, she was a civil servant, she's retired now. And there was this, I mean, it's in 1999, there was this sudden increase in wages for all civil servants across the country. I mean, the minimum wage was increased, I think something around 7,500. I was a pupil in secondary school. Even myself, I benefited from that in some sort of way, you know, which means that if the economy works, if public spending grows, if the environment is stimulated, everybody would benefit from it. So when we talk about GDP, it's not an abstract term. It's that it's the sum of the total of the economy, and I mean, which also you contribute to. So if you are selling tomatoes and you are just by the roadside, if nobody's buying from you, then you are not having turnover, then you are not increasing your sales, then definitely you cannot get much more profit. Then definitely you cannot even, you know, you cannot even invest, and you also expend on other items, on other non-food items. We are flirting with when people are losing jobs. We are flirting with the time where consumption is contracting. And so definitely it's going to affect everybody, right? From those who do agriculture or those who don't even do agriculture, or those who do non-essential services. the entire world is in a retreating mode, and so definitely there will be challenges to that. And I think everybody has to have that mindset and that understanding. It's just unfortunate that Nigeria does not run on the proper social contract theory, because these are the times where the government is supposed to stand up for the people and say, you know what, we're going to open, you know, our treasury, we're going to support people massively, we're going to provide palliative for small businesses more than necessary, we're going to support the informal market, students, I mean, farmers and the rest. I mean, I've heard bits and pieces of that, but not at the scale where that an average Nigerian feels it, because we don't have a structured, even though I have a proper citizen database. We don't even know who we are.
Okay.
We don't even know Nigerian. I mean, those are the questions that
we have to ask. All right, so Olusegun, let me put in some questions from our viewers. Good evening, ladies. You're all looking great. I agree with Mr. Ogunbinde that Nigeria don't have a budget. That's why all past and present administrations panic. In the mid-year after the budget, ministers applied to federal government for more funds, lying of completion and incomplete projects. This lingers on from one government to another. Do you agree with, I think this is Ade from London. Do you agree with him about, you know, padding or transferring budget from one year to another? Then somebody, Kelvin, is saying, what is your take on Chinese loans? Then Ola says, I don't understand why we have constituency projects in a budget. Those are the three questions. Maybe you just take one now, and then we'll take a quick break, then we'll go for the next ones.
I mean, so if we say the budget, I mean, padding. Well, padding are across different levels. People, legislators pad, which means people secretly. Padding is just people saying.
Olusegun, can you hear me? I think we'll take a break. When we return, we'll reconnect with Olusegun. Please stay with us. We'll be right back.